Hey guys, it's Jessica Garrity. I created this video for my Graphic Design Essentials course as a brief intro to Photoshop. Of course, there's tons you can do with this program, but I'm just going to be covering the basics for now. So let's get started. Whenever you want to open up a file, you go up here to the File menu and choose Open. You navigate to the file you'd like to open, so I'm going to choose the Vintage Camera JPEG and click Open. So here you can see the file name. Alright, so then over on the right here we have our Layers panel. If your workspace doesn't look like mine, you can update it by going Window, Workspace, making sure Essentials is selected, and then just click on Reset Essentials. So over here in our Layers panel, when you first open a photo, by default it's going to be set as the background layer and it's going to be locked. So to unlock it, we're just going to go ahead and click on this lock icon right here. So there we have our layer. Now if we want to create additional layers, you just click on this new layer icon right here, and you can see it just created that new empty one above it. If I wanted to duplicate this layer, you just go ahead and click and drag, and it just created a copy of that base photo. If I want to group images, you click on this little folder, and it creates a group. So I just create a new layer within that group, and now I'm going to drag my image into that group as well. So now they're all in there together. If you want to rename these files, just go ahead and double click on the title. So I'm going to call this Photo Group Empty Layer and Vintage Camera, just for demonstration purposes. So over here on the left side, you should have your Tools panel. At the very top, you should see this little icon. That's your Move tool. The Move tool is pretty self-explanatory. It moves layers. So for example, right now I have the Vintage Camera layer selected. So if I click and drag on my canvas, it's going to move that layer. Now if I hold Shift while I'm dragging, it's going to constrain that movement to either horizontal or vertical. So that's by holding Shift. Below that we have our Marquee tool, and these are used for making selections in certain shapes. So for example, if you wanted to make a rectangle shape, you just select that tool and then click and drag. Now if you hold Shift, it's going to constrain that to a perfect square. And if you hold Alt, it begins that selection where you first clicked. So, for example, let's say I'm hitting Command D to deselect. So let's say I wanted to select around this lens area. I'm starting sort of in the middle of it, and now I'm holding Alt to center it where I first clicked, and I'm also holding Shift to constrain that to a perfect circle. So the area within those dotted lines, that's my selection. So I'm selecting the Move tool, and you can see I can move it around. If I wanted to bring that onto a new layer, there's a few different ways to do it. You can go ahead and do Edit Copy, and then Edit Paste. So as you can see, that just pasted it onto its own layer. You could also do Command C for Copy, and Command V for Paste. So if you want to delete layers, you can either hit Delete while you have it selected, or you could drag it down to this little trash can here. So here we have our Lasso tools. The basic Lasso tool is sort of a free selection tool. You click and drag, and it's going to be selecting everything within the area that you're selecting. So it just selected that weird shape. The polygonal Lasso tool is useful if you want to create straight selections. So for example, I just clicked, click again, click, click, and just create something like that. If you want to close the selection, you can either click back at the starting point, or you can just double click. There's also the magnetic lasso tool. This is useful for selecting objects when there's a lot of contrast. So for example, I want to select this edge here. I just clicked once, and now I'm just moving my cursor, and it's automatically snapping to the edges. So again, that's useful if there is a lot of contrast. So up here, you'll find some other selection options. By default, Create New Selection is automatically chosen. There's also Add to Selection, Subtract from Selection, and Intersect with Selection. So when we have New Selection chosen, it's going to do basically what it says. It creates a new selection. So I just created that. If I click somewhere else, it creates a new one. When I create that selection, if you notice, when you hover over it, your cursor changes. That allows me to move that selection. If I have Add to Selection chosen, then what it does is it adds to my selection. So right now I have this square. Now it has that square, and everywhere I go, it's just going to keep adding to it. If you choose Subtract from Selection, then again, it subtracts from the selection. So I have this cut out, I'm removing that. So Remove from Selection basically cuts out your selection. So let's say I want to go ahead and choose this camera area, but I don't want that lens in there. So I'm holding Alt and Shift and selecting that lens area. So what it did was it cut out that area from my selection. All right, now Intersect with Selection. What it does is, let's say I have a selection. So I just selected this big old circle. If I use Intersect with Selection, only the area in between my selections is going to remain selected. So that's it. So over here we have the Quick Selection tool and the Magic Wand tool. And the Quick Selection tool basically works like the Brush tool. You click and drag, and it's sort of painting that selection. I'm going to keep going, and it keeps selecting. The way it makes that selection is that it's automatically finding and following the defined edges in the image. So again, that works by establishing contrast. It can see that harsh line in between the black around the camera and the lighter area. I'm hitting Command D to remove that selection. And so the Magic Wand tool, the way this works is it makes a selection based on the color range. So for example, I want to select this little Kodak. I just clicked, and it automatically selects nearly the entire thing just because it was red. You're choosing exactly which range it's selecting based on the initial area you click. The tolerance is what's going to affect how much is selected. So right now it's at 100, so it's selected a lot, but let's say I didn't want this area selected. I'm going to bump that down a little bit to, let's say, 40. So now it's selecting less. If I hold Shift, I can add to that selection through the Magic Wand tool. Below that, we have the Crop, Perspective, and Slice tools. So with the Crop tool, you can actually select exactly what size you want to crop it to. So for example, if I wanted this to be like a perfect square, so we're going to do 5 inches by 5 inches, 72, we're getting ready for web. It automatically set that for me. So then if I go ahead and hit enter, there it is. My perfect 5 inch by 5 inch square at 72 dpi. I'm going to go ahead and undo that. I'm going to clear my selection. Your other option is to set it to ratio, and then you can drag it yourself. In that little black box up at the top left of my selection, you can see the exact size that it's constraining it to. The eyedropper tool allows me to make selections based off of my image. So if I wanted this exact red in the Kodak logo, I can just click on that and it's going to select it for me. And you can see that in the foreground color. The area behind it is the background color. You can switch between these two by clicking on this icon, the little arrows, or by clicking X. If you press D or click here, it's going to reset those colors back to the original scheme. Below that, we have some of our other healing tools. So the spot healing brush tool, this is good for getting rid of little areas. You just click and it automatically pulls from the area around it to cover up that selection. The healing brush tool is very similar to the clone stamp tool. It's good for repairing scratches, specs, things like that. It works kind of like the brush tool, so you can choose your cursor size. And then what you would do is you hold Alt. So you hold down Alt to select a nice clean area. And then you click to place over it. I'm jumping around a little bit, but this is very similar to the clone stamp tool. It works the exact same way, except it doesn't blend at the end. It's more of a direct copy of the information from the first selected area to the second. With the patch tool, you initially select the area that you want to cover up, and then you choose the area you want to pull from. So it's basically taking the information from your second selection and placing that over the first. Below that, we have our brush tool. You can also hit B to select that. There's also the pencil tool, mixer brush tool, all of those options. But you can make adjustments to the brush by clicking right up here. You can adjust the size of it and the hardness or the softness. And you can also select from different brush tips. You can also view more options by going Window, Brush, and then you can make adjustments to the shape dynamics, the size in between each brush mark, and things like that. And then to use the brush, you just click and drag. There's also the eraser tool. The eraser tool works similar to the brush tool. You can adjust the size of it. Right now I'm holding close bracket to make it smaller. You can also hit open bracket to make it larger. Or you can adjust the size here. You have a lot of options. And then if you wanted to erase, you just click and drag. So right now it's not really removing my entire image like I want it to. That's because the opacity is set to only 10%. I want it to be 100%, so now it removes the entire selection. Below that we have our gradient tool, and underneath that is also the paint bucket tool. So the way that works is you just click and it fills your area. So if you want just to fill a selection, you'd make that selection. Click on the paint bucket tool and click. With the gradient tool, there are a few presets that you can choose from. These automatically pull from your foreground and background. So even though it shows as black and white right now, if we were to select that other color, you could see that that changed to that reddish color. And then the white is my background right now. The blur tool blurs certain areas. Sharpen tool sharpens it, makes it a little more pixelated. And the smudge tool smudges. Those are all pretty self-explanatory as well. There's also the dodge, burn, and sponge tools. So the dodge tool lightens. You can choose whether it affects the shadows, midtones, or highlights right up here. And the burn tool darkens, and it works in a similar way. And then the sponge tool desaturates. So you can see when I use this, it's pulling the color out from everywhere I'm clicking and dragging over. And remember, with all of these tools, you can still adjust the size similar to the way you would with the brush tool. If you want to ever apply text to your image, you select the text tool. So below the text tool, we have the shape tool. If you click and hold, you can choose between the different shapes that you want to create. To use them, all you have to do is click and drag, and you can also hold shift to constrain those properties and make it a perfect square or a perfect circle, depending on the shape you choose. You can also choose to change the stroke by clicking under the properties and selecting the different colors you'd like. And you can adjust the thickness of that. Or you can choose to have no fill. There's also the Move tool. This allows you to move around your canvas. Another shortcut for that would be to hold Shift. The Zoom tool allows you to zoom in and out on your image. You can hold Command minus or Command plus as shortcuts. And it'll show you exactly how close you're zoomed in right down here. You can also click up here to automatically set it to 100%, fit screen, or fill screen. Down here you have your current foreground and background color. We kind of went over those earlier. If you double click on the color, it opens up your color picker. This allows you to be a little more specific with your selection. You can also choose to alter it by the RGB values, the CMYK values, or the hex values. So you just select the color you want and click OK. If you want to switch to the background color, you just click on these arrows. Something else to keep in mind is by clicking on the little eye icon next to your layer, you can choose to hide or reveal it. So that's pretty much it for our Photoshop Tools overview. Again, these are just the basics to get you started. You're definitely encouraged to go experiment with the tools on your own time. If you have any questions in the meantime, please feel free to shoot me an email at garritygraphics@gmail.com.